Beautiful name it is, and nothing compares. Good morning, welcome. Welcome to Calvary Cameron Park. Welcome to the Resurrection Sunday service. Welcome to the Easter Sunday service. Welcome to the Sunrise service, S-O-N, Sunrise service at Calvary Cameron Park. I want to share a scripture with you. This is from Romans chapter 4. It's talking about how Abraham was believing God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. This is Romans 4, 22 through 25. And therefore it was accredited to him for righteousness. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was accredited to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be accredited, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses, and raised again for our justification. And that last verse, I like to read it personal, and I encourage everybody to take it personal, that Jesus our Lord was delivered for my offenses and was raised again for my justification. I want to give praise and thanks to his name, especially on this day. Lord, just prepare our hearts, Lord, to hear your voice and to know your will. Touch our lives in a greater way that we can celebrate the sunrise every day of our lives. And give you praise in Jesus' name. Please stand.
Sons of men. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Why don't you greet one another?
They got it.
Huh?
They got it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, we are alive this morning in more ways than one. Amen?
Amen.
Welcome to Resurrection Sunday. You know, there's a song out there by a gentleman named Zach Williams. It's called Sunday's Coming. And it's about different trials. He sings about people going through different trials. It says it may feel like Friday, but Sunday's coming, right? So if you're going through trials, and we all are, just remember, one, the Lord is always with us, and two, as bad as it may seem, as those disciples on Thursday night and Friday night and Saturday night, but man, what about the glory on Sunday morning, amen? And he's risen. You know, they've been trying to stuff a body in that grave for 2,000 years, and they can't find it because it's not there. He's in heaven, amen? And that's where we're headed, and that's where he's going to bring us home one day. Okay, let's do some quick announcements. If you need a pen or a Bible, if you'd raise your hand, the ushers would get you one or both. Encourage you to detach the prayer and praise report. Hey, y'all got to praise today. It's Resurrection Sunday. Amen? But we want to be a house of prayer, but we need to know what you guys have specific prayer needs for. So encourage you to write them down. If you've got a praise report, write that down. It's edifying to the body to go through those. We want to pray for you guys. We want to get very specific, but you need to help us out. So fill it out, drop it in the offering bag, and or the offering box there on the left side of the door. So quick announcements. We have every Sunday at 9 a.m. in this classroom right here, we have a prayer meeting. You guys are all welcome to come. We just pray for whatever the Lord has on your heart and just encourage you guys to come. We have slow down. See, I got to running too fast and this little brain. I'm not getting old. It's not my memory because of my age. I told my wife the other day, it's my chemo brain. I blame it all on the chemo I had. So anyway, we have a radio outreach ministry. That's 710 AM, 105.7 FMs, Wednesdays at 11 PM, Fridays at 4:30 PM, Saturdays at 4 PM, and Sundays at 6 AM. Look, it's like an invitation. This is just a rebroadcast of God's word, and we need his word in this world so desperately. So we want you guys to just, to your loved ones, to your friends, to your coworkers, say, hey, tune in. And here's what our church is about, and it's all about the word of God because it never goes out void. Amen? All right. So we have our Friday home fellowship. We'll be back on this Friday going through the book of Matthew. I encourage you to come, even if you have not come before. It's a fresh study every week. It's an interactive study. That way you don't have to listen to me bloviate for the whole time. And it's good, right? We have a good time. We break the bread, the word, and then we go break bread. And encourage you guys to come. We have our men's discipleships at 7 a.m. here on Saturday mornings in this classroom. Going through the book of Acts. It's a fresh study every Saturday. Encourage you guys to come. Hey, listen, we've got new young ones in our house. We've got new babies in the house, right? So we need some nursery people, right, to help so the moms can come in and enjoy church and have someone take care of their little ones. So if you're interested, please see Judy. Our next house of prayer, which is we meet after service, will be on April 14th. So I encourage you guys to do that. And on the 21st of next month, well, yeah, I won't say Christmas. I just won't say it. I'm not going to say it. Anyway, on the 21st, we're going to have a potluck. Mexican dish is the theme. Every time I try to go on a diet, I come to church. Doesn't seem to work. Maybe it's my willpower. I don't know. Anyway, that'll be a great time. And then the women have a retreat coming up on May 3rd through the 5th. If you're interested, see Judy. And then the first big kickoff of the year is our barbecue cook-off. Where's Peter? How big are the trophies, Peter? Because when you're not here, they're like really big, by the way. No, listen, it's a great time. Gosh, for a Texas boy to smell meat sizzling on a grill at 7 in the morning is good stuff. Anyway, it's fun. And it's everybody wins because you guys and gals know how to cook. So it's a good time. We encourage you for that. And with that, I'm done, but I'm going to pray for the offering really quick. So, Lord, we come to you this morning. Lord, if we're not cheerful this morning, we don't have a morning we can be cheerful on. All I got to say is because, Lord, you've risen. And that's what it's all about, Lord. That's what our hope hangs on, Lord, is that you defeated death. You defeated sin. You defeated Satan. You defeated everything, Lord. You are our King. You are our Lord. And you are King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And, Lord, so this morning we want to receive these tithes and offerings, Lord. It's not a payback schedule, Lord. It's just a way of honoring what you've done in our lives individually and corporately. And, Lord, we pray that you're sovereign down to the last widow's mite. We love you and we praise you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Thank you. Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures.
Good morning. You guys have a seat. Today is a family service. We do have child care, a children's ministry for the little ones, but not for the older ones. So just so you know that, hey, I'd appreciate you guys praying for my wife. She woke up this morning. and says, I don't feel good, and, you know, we're going to try to get mom to church. And I just said, go back to bed. She's got some type of a stomach bug. I said, you don't need to be spreading that to anybody. And so she did. I ran over, got her some ginger ale, and hopefully she's resting at home. Hey, open your Bibles to Luke 24. Luke 24. And as you're opening, let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning, and thank you for raising from the dead, Lord. Man, what a day this is that we celebrate. We actually celebrate the resurrection every day of our lives as believers. Because, Lord, we know that because you live, we can face tomorrow, that all our fears are gone, our guilt is gone, our shame is gone. Oh, Lord, thank you. Hallelujah. Bless our time in your word. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Title of this morning's message is The Stone Has Rolled Away. The stone has rolled away. The greatest news, the stone has rolled away. Now, I'm going to put some stuff on the screen. Don't put it on the screen quite yet, someone. But I'm going to put some stuff on the screen. And you guys know the routine. We've done this before. And I need some audience participation. And if I don't get it, I'm going to keep doing it until I get it, okay? I just want you guys to know, we're going to keep doing this, all right? I'm going to mention the well-known prophet or so-called man of God, and we're going to talk about his tomb, and we're going to talk about whether he's in there or not. And this is where I need you guys to participate. I need you to say the word occupied, all right? You guys ready? Comes on the screen. Here we go. Here we go. Confucius' tomb is what? Bahamas, Buddha's tomb is what?
Occupied.
Muhammad's tomb is what?
Occupied.
Let's do it again. Confucius?
Occupied.
Buddha's?
Occupied.
Muhammad's?
Occupied.
Jesus's. Oh, man. Thank you, Lord, right? I mean, seriously, thank you, Lord. It's the most important day of our faith. It's not about the bunny. You guys, every time I hear bunny... Okay, Radshack and Benny. How many of you guys know Radshack and Benny from VeggieTales? Raise your hand. Okay, like four of you. Okay, it's about Nebuchadnezzar raising up a statue, and he calls the statue the bunny, and he sings the bunny song. And he goes to, you know, Radshack or Benny, whichever one he goes to. He says, I need you to sing the bunny song. He goes, I don't know if I'm familiar with that tune. He goes, the bunny, the bunny. Okay, I won't go any further. Trust me. All right, you thought I was going to sing the whole thing, didn't you? You guys are like all disappointed now, aren't you? No, I'm not going to sing. It's not about, hey, if you're going to have an Easter egg hunt today, praise God, right? I mean, when I was a kid, if somebody hid something and I had to go find it, that was a fun game to play, especially when it was hide and seek and you're looking for your buddy or something, you know? Boy, when I was running the youth, we had this game. What did they call it? Sardines or something like that. I can't remember what it was called, but we had that huge sanctuary at Auburn, and we would tell people to go hide. And when you found them, you actually had to hide with them until there was only one person left, and then that person was it for the next time. Anyway, that was a fun game. All right, I don't know why I digressed on that, but boy, I just had a flashback to my youth pastor days. Hey, it's about our greatest need this day. What takes place, what Jesus did, his death, burial, and resurrection. It's about our greatest need, and you know the greatest need we have is to be forgiven. You know, Ernest Hemingway tells a story about a Spanish father whose son and him had some issues, and the son had ran away. I guess he'd done some bad things to the father, and the father was disparaging his son. And so he took out an ad in the local paper that said, Paco, meet me at Hotel Montana at noon on Tuesday. All is forgiven. Love, Papa. Well, did you know that that's a very common name in Spanish, Paco? And the next Tuesday that showed up at noon, there were over 800 Pecos looking to reconcile with their father. You see, the greatest need we have is to be forgiven, to be forgiven. The greatest need we have is to know that we are free from guilt, that we are free from the guilt and the shame. The greatest need we have is to be reconciled with our Heavenly Father. And that's what Jesus did when he came and he went to the cross. Hey, Samantha, would you turn those lights on? It's a little dark for me over here. It's one of those switches back there. I don't know which one. Thanks. Where was I going? Yeah, the greatest need. I got it. I caught it. Senior moment. Boy, I'm having more of those, you guys. I don't know what you're going to do, but hey, I'm having more of them. But you know, our greatest need is to be forgiven. And that's why Jesus came to earth in the form of a human being, of a baby boy. He went to the cross. He took your sins and my sins upon it. That was the punishment that our sins deserve, was death. And it's as if to say that with one hand, he has a hold of the Father, and with the other hand, he's reaching out to all mankind. That's our greatest need, is to be reconciled to the Father. That's why the first time he came to wear the crown. He came to bear the cross. He came to do that instead of setting up a political ring. He's coming back the second time to do that. He's coming back with us, by the way, to do that. The greatest need is to be reconciled to the Father. And that's what Jesus Christ did in raising from the dead. And if you're in Christ this morning, guess what? You're reconciled. You're forgiven. If you're in Christ today, it says this in 2 Corinthians, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is what? New. Does it say remade? Does it say rebuilt? No, what does new creation mean? Well, I'll tell you, he goes on to say it. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Do you feel brand new today? I know not in our bodies, right? Some of us are aching and going, oh, man, this body, right? Especially Alan, you know, he's like 95,000 years old. Sorry, it's been a while, Alan. I just had to pick on you. But, you know, I brought this up on Friday, guys. I don't know why the Lord gave me this illustration a week or so ago, but if you had given one thing that you could go back and change in your life that still brings you shame and guilt, one thing, and God says, I'll let you go back and fix that one thing, and that one thing pops into your head right now, right? It's already gone. Do you guys understand what I'm saying here? It's already gone. Okay, we may have to live with the consequences of our decisions till this life is passed and the next life comes. But before the Father, the slate is wiped clean. Before the Father, it's covered under the blood of Christ. That's what this day represents. Amen? In the importance of the resurrection, if Jesus is not raised from the dead, he's just another one of the thousands of people who was crucified by Rome for a cause. If he has not risen from the dead, everything Jesus did was a waste of time. If he has not risen from the dead, then he is a liar. And why are we here following a liar? There's a whole lot of other things we could be doing. If Jesus has not risen from the dead, we are still dead in our sins. As it says in 1 Corinthians 5:17, if Christ has not risen, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. If Jesus has not risen from the dead, there is no point in us even being here today. We should have just stayed home, watched TV, and eat a bunch of Twinkies. Amen? Because that's going to be the only comfort you're going to find in life is food. But because he has, we could celebrate. Jesus made some very bold statements. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except to be through me. And the resurrection is God's stamp of approval on Jesus, on what he did and what he taught and everything he is about. The resurrection guarantees us that Jesus has conquered sin, death, and hell. The resurrection guarantees that all his promises are yes and amen, and we can bank on it. Isn't that the greatest news we've ever heard? Amen. I don't know about you guys, but I'm just so glad that my sin and my guilt and my shame are covered under the blood of Christ. How can I be certain the resurrection is true? Number one, the Bible confirms it. That's all I need, really. That's all I need. The Bible says it happened. I believe it. Doesn't matter what I think about it or anybody else thinks about it in this world. The Bible says it. I believe it. History confirms it, though. No honest historian is going to doubt Jesus ever lived. What they're trying to do is tell you that somehow the disciples stole the body or the body was missing in some other ways, but they've yet to find the body. They've yet to find the body. Number three, the boldness of the disciples. Remember how they went from hiding and cowering to standing strong? You see, the boldness of the disciples also is an illustration. Is like, hey, let's just think about this for a minute. You know, honest historians will admit, yep, Jesus, yep. Time changed with Jesus. So, yeah, clearly something happened. Jesus was here. No honest historian will doubt that. What they do is they try to say, well, the disciples stole the body. Well, let's just say you guys were all disciples at the time, and hey, you know what? Let's devise this plan and steal the body. Okay, that's going to work out great until they come to my house and say, I'm going to kill your wife and kids unless you denounce Christ. And then we're going to say, like, well, wait, hold on a second. It was just a big joke. Let me show you where the body is. It's over here. Because I'm not going to knowingly die or have my wife and kids die for a lie. I'm not going to knowingly do that. I'm going to at some point, unless I'm really stupid and stubborn and psychotic, I'm going to say, no, wait a second. They didn't do that. And I always quote this every Easter. I'm going to quote it again. Charles Colson said this, I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate actually proves it to me. How? Because 12 men testified that they had seen Jesus raised from the dead. Then they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Everyone was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured that if it weren't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they could not keep a lie for 3 weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep a lie for 40 years? Absolutely impossible. The fourth proof is right here, that the resurrection exists. Every single one of your lives that has changed. You don't have to raise your hand, but we're all former what? Something. Something. Drug addicts. Adulterers. Fornicators. Right? We're all former something. You just fill in the blank of all the sins that we could do. We're all former something. That proves it. You see, you can't change lives is one of the biggest testimonies to the fact that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. And the world just scratches its head and wonders, wait a second, I knew you before, and now I know you now, and something is radically different. Your life has changed. So let's look at our text in Luke briefly. Then we're going to celebrate communion. We're going to celebrate what it is that he did for us. And the first thing we're going to look at is the angel of the Lord rolled the stone away, verse 1. And now on the first day of the week, pause. You know I bring this up a lot, but it's important to understand what the first day of the week is. The first day of the week is Sunday. It's today. On the Jewish calendar, the Sabbath, the last day of the week, would be Saturday. And so Saturday is the Sabbath. And so here they are coming to the grave on the very first day of the week, very early in the morning. And what we see here is the first day of the week is now why we attend church on Sunday. This is important for us to know. Unfortunately, there's a lot of people out there that just have this impression that we should still be going to church on Saturdays. And actually, some of these people will actually say, you going to church on Sundays is actually an abomination. It's a sin. Well, we see all the way through the Old Testament that on the first day of the week, which is Sunday, the apostles, the disciples, all started to meet on that day to celebrate the very fact that Jesus rose from the grave on Sunday, the first day of the week. And then it goes on to say very early in the morning, my guys, my precious brothers and sisters, listen, these guys got up very early. They were on fire to go to the tomb, to see Jesus, to finish the preparation. And I just want to encourage you with this very early in the morning. We need to make sure that we're giving God the first fruits of our day. Can I get an amen to that? Amen. You know, something, you know, when I was working in the restaurant business and my hours were all over the map, sometimes I found the best time was actually in the evening. And so it's okay if you have to have a devotion at different times of the day because of your work schedule. But what I have found out now is that if I don't stop and pause first thing in the morning, my day kind of just unravels. And that necessarily doesn't mean everything's always out of control and chaotic, but it's not as focused as it should be, especially with the study of God's Word. I got to get up in the morning, and I got to get up, and I got to say, hey, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to turn my attention to the Lord. And that's why from the time I get up till about noon, sometimes there's a little bit of radio silence when people try to call or text because I am giving that section of the day solely to the Lord. I try to avoid all distractions. My wife, you know, if she's home, our conversations, you know, we'll read in the morning, we'll have our devotion. And then, but I try to just make sure I stay focused on the things of the Lord. And so I just want to encourage you guys, make sure you're giving the Lord the first fruits of your morning. These gals came early. These certain women came early in the morning to see, to finish up what was not able to be finished up because of the Passovers, because of the Sabbaths. The women, we have Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and certain other women with them, including Joanna. Now listen, I don't know about you guys, but do you ever get confused about the Marys in the Bible? There's so many Marys, right? So many James, too. Okay, which James is this one talking about? But these gals loved them, and they were special. They were special to Jesus, and Jesus was special to them. And you think about them. I mean, what a wonderful group of women they are. Here they are. While the disciples are really cowering, they're boldly before the cross. They're with Jesus. And they want to make sure that Jesus is taken care of and that he's given a proper burial. And so they're there first thing in the morning to do that. Mary Magdalene in particular, you know, she had 7 demons that Jesus cast out of her. And so that relationship that she had with Jesus was incredible. She loved Jesus. She worshiped Jesus. She was She was absolutely sold out for him, and she's one of the gals who's there. And I always got to read this, too, because this, to me, is very special about the Easter Sunday morning, is that Mary's response and interaction with Jesus. And so it's on the screen from John's Gospel, chapter 20. But Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one on the head and the other on the feet where the body of Jesus was laying. And then they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him, "Rabboni, Rabboni, Rabboni, Rabboni," which is to say, "Teacher." As I go through the text of Easter, resurrection, as I go through this, this story to me is one of the most touching and special stories in the account. Why? Why do you say that? Well, here's why I say it. Because she doesn't even know it's Jesus. She goes, take me to him. I'll take him away. I'll take him off your hands. I'll take care of him because he's so precious to me. He's my Lord. He freed me. He saved me. I once was this. Now I'm this. All because of Jesus. I owe him everything. She didn't know it was him until he said, "Mary." And this always gets me. Mary. You know, it's kind of like if your wife calls your name from across the room. You know it. You hear it. You understand it. You connect it. You see it. You hear the phrase and the tone in which she uses. And you know. You know. And this is what's happening to Mary here. She's like there. She's not really paying attention. "Oh, you're the gardener. Where's he at?" Da, 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 da. And he goes, "Mary. Mary. Oh, my gosh. Rabboni, you're the teacher, you're the Lord. Oh, my goodness." He knows her. He knows her name. And she knows his voice. And she knows him. Isn't that beautiful? And he knows you the same way. And he calls you. He has a name. We have a new name that we don't know about. But we know when we hear his voice, don't we? And listen, I said this on Friday, and it's worth repeating. But you know I'm his favorite. I mean, did you guys ever do that with mom and dad, right? "Mom and dad, I know I'm your favorite son. You know, well, you're my only son." No, I'm just kidding. I wasn't. I had two other brothers. But you know what I'm saying? We always like to do that, right? But you know what? Think about this. And I know you guys all know where I'm going. But it's worth repeating anyways. You're his favorite too. And somehow when I'm sitting down talking to him, there's nobody else in the entire universe, in heaven or anywhere else. It's just him and I. You know, and you know, I know Crazy Mike might be trying to get in, but it's just him and I, you know. But no, he's with Mike too. And it's the same type of an attention that he's given to him, that he's given to me. Why? Because he knows us. He knows our name. He knows your name. And you know his voice. To me, that's one of the most, and I'll probably have that in almost every Easter message or resurrection message I give from here on out to the day I see him face to face, because it's just so important to me. Now here they come, the last part of verse 1, they come to the tomb to bring the spices which they had prepared. Well, okay, so what the normal thing was is what, you know, when somebody would die, you would prepare the spices, wrap them in the linen cloths, and they'd have the proper, you know, procedures done before a burial. But because they couldn't do this because it was getting night on the day of preparation, which was Thursday, as we were here, yes, if you were here on Friday, you know about Thursday was a day of preparation. He came into Jerusalem on Nisan 10th, which was Palm Sunday. On the 14th, which is the day of preparation, he was crucified. He was put on the altar at 9 a.m. He was put on the cross at 9 a.m., just like the Passover lambs. And at 3 p.m., he gave up his spirit. He said it was finished, gave up his spirit. They asked him, "Hey, we can't leave the body up over Passover, you know, over our Sabbaths." We had two Sabbaths, one because of unleavened bread, the other one because of the normal one, which would be the normal Friday to Saturday. So here it is now, 3 days later, Jesus said 3 days and three nights in the tomb. 3 days later, they're coming to the tomb to finish the task of burying him that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus had started but could not finish because of the Sabbath that was taking place. So that's why they're coming to the tomb early in the morning. Now, they faced a problem as they were going to this tomb, didn't they? So the question they would have to ask is how are we going to move this stone? And God, in Mark's gospel, he says that they were actually very concerned about how they were going to remove the stone. Why? Because they faced obstacles with this stone. You know, the first obstacle they faced was, as you know, the Pharisees went to the Roman government and said, hey, you know, there was talk about resurrection, and we don't want this guy, you know, we don't want an insurrection here, so you guys might want to put a seal on the tomb. Well, the Roman seal was the seal that you put on a tomb, and if you mess with the Roman seal, it was punishable by death. You know, kind of like a signet ring where you have the little wax and you seal your letter, and if that letter is meant for that person and somebody else opens it, they find it open, that seal has been broken, punishable by death. And so they're going to have a sealed tomb. That's the first problem they're going to face. How are we going to break this seal and have Rome not kill us? The second obstacle they're going to face is the Roman guards, which could have been anywhere from 4 to 16 men. Most likely it was 16 men. They had overnight duties. These were been the best of the best trained men. They were actually believed that the Roman soldiers, four of them, could actually, maintain a 16 square foot radius just with four men and their tactics and the way they fought. So they were well trained Roman guards on duty. Four would stay awake at a time while the rest of the men would sleep. They would take turns. The men who would sleep in a circle with their heads facing each other like this, in a position ready to go at any minute. The punishment for falling asleep, if you were one of the four, meant that all of the 16 would die. So no one was going to let anybody fall asleep, period, because you knew the consequences were everybody was going to die. So they have a sealed tomb. They have the Roman guards. What are they possibly going to do? And if there wasn't a Roman seal, and if there wasn't a Roman guards, did you know the stone was so huge it was probably 1.5 to 2 tons? That's the size of a small vehicle. Our vehicles aren't that small anymore, so maybe our vehicle's a little bit more money and more weight. But listen, how are a bunch of women going to be able to move a 1.5 to 2 ton stone? It's believed in the traditions that it would actually take 20 strong men to move the stone. And it's believed that as the stone, you know, before the grave was filled, that the stone would be on an incline, and it would be rolled up by the 20 men and held in place. And then when the body was put inside the tomb, boom, they released that what was holding it. It would roll into place. So to push it back out of place was going to require an awful lot of men. And there's no way these gals could have done it. And there's no way the disciples would have done it because they're still hiding. The men are still hiding. But verse 2 gives us the answer, and that's the title of our message. Let's read it together. You guys got your text there, right? But, read it together with me out loud. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. That was kind of weak. Let's try it again. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. It's gone. It's already there. The stone is rolled away. Not to let Jesus out, but to let us in to see that he's already gone. Amen? Listen to what it says in Matthew's account, Matthew 28, verse 2. And behold, it's on the screen. There was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. Just some unknown angel. Boom, boom, boom. His countenance was like lightning and his clothes as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him. And they became like dead men. Yeah, you bet. Every time you see an angel of the Lord in Scripture or an angel in Scripture, you see people going, whoa, this is an intense situation that's taking place. And the angel just simply moved the stone away. Again, not to let Jesus out, but that we could come in and see that he was gone. So the women now react with confusion and fear. Verse 3 of Luke 24. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Oh, I love that too. "He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all things to the 11 and to the rest, and to all the rest." So there's confusion. They're perplexed. They're going, "Where's the body? Where is he at? Why isn't he here?" They were afraid. They were afraid. That fear actually turned into great joy when you look at Matthew's account in verse 8 of chapter 28. "So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring the disciples' words." Their fear was accompanied by joy, because now there is a glimmer of hope that he actually has raised from the dead. The two men standing there, obviously angels, they announce the resurrection of Christ. They are faithful to deliver the message, and so should you and I be. The angels gave the message. He's not here. He has risen from the dead. And that's the message we give to a lost and confused and crazy world. And then he says at the end of verse 5, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Why are you surprised by this? This shouldn't catch you off guard. He's been talking to you about this. He's not here. The angels seem perplexed that they're perplexed. Why didn't they get this? I mean, I know we're slow of learning sometimes. Or is it just me? All right, can I get an amen, or am I on this tree alone? I'm on this branch. But we're talking slow of learning here too, because Jesus kept telling them what he's going to do. And they're like, "Well, why are you here? Didn't you hear him when he said it on this occasion, this occasion, this occasion?" He goes, "Roll the film. Look at all the times he said it. How come you're so confused?" I know we're slow. We're not always able to catch on, but I'm grateful that we can catch on through the Holy Spirit working in our hearts. But he is not here. He is not here. They have not found the body yet. He is not here. He has risen. His tomb is empty. And then, let me remind you of the things he said. Guys, when you're confused about things in life, let me remind you of the things he said. Amen? And be unconfused, right? Because it's right here. It's right here. All his promises. And then verse 10, the disciples refused to believe it. It was Mary Magdalene, Jonah, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them, who told these things to the apostles. So they were faithful to deliver the message too. The first evangelists in church history were women: Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James. Here they are spreading the news. As the angels told them, as they saw with their own eyes, they're repeating what they have been told and what they knew to be true. But the apostles said their words seemed like idle tales, and they did not believe them. That's interesting. Can you imagine how excited you would be? You're running back, and you know Peter, I know you denied him, but I want to tell you something. He's not there, and the angels told us he's raised from the dead. And you know, and James and John, and guys, listen, he's not dead anymore. He's alive. And the guys are sitting there, you know, having their morning coffee. "Oh, that sounds, no way. Come on, give me a break. Come on, stop with the fairy tales." Their hearts weren't in the right place, were they? I can't help but think about this when I look at this. You see, the problem here, how disappointed the women might have been, but the problem here is the human heart. It doesn't want to see. And you see, when people don't want to see Jesus in our world, you and I can do the best that we can to love them and to persuade them, but it has to be a work of the Holy Spirit in their life. You know, so, I've said this, and I get myself in trouble sometimes in certain places, but apologetics, understanding and how to defend the scriptures, I don't know how useful that is in witnessing to our friends and loved ones. What they need to hear is that we're all sinners and we need a Savior, and we need help outside of ourself. You and I, the same mind that messed this life up, is messing this world up, isn't capable of fixing it. We need help outside of ourselves. We need a Savior, and His name is Jesus Christ. And He loves you enough to take the punishment of your sins upon the cross. This is the message that we share with non-believers. Not do we, sometimes I spend so many times in the past, I regret this, arguing about, no, it's literally 24-hour days. Let me show you in the Hebrew. And they're not a believer, but they believe in evolution. And so you're trying to convince them through the scriptures. Oh, okay, maybe there's a place for that with some people, but I don't really personally believe it. Because here you have the knowledge that they came with, and they just rejected it and considered it idle talk. What they needed to have happen was their hearts needed to be transformed by the reality of what took place at that grave. That makes sense? That's what people need to hear. I mean, and if you can impress them with all your knowledge in certain things, but if you can't tell them that Jesus loves them, it reminds me of that story of the little girl who got saved, and the only Bible verse she knew was John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever would believe on Him would not perish but have everlasting life." She ran across a skeptic in the street, and she was sharing how much Jesus had changed her life and how everything was so wonderful. And the guy says, "Well, you mean to tell me that you actually believe that God created the world in 7 days? She goes, "I don't know anything about that. Here's the only thing I know. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son." Are you trying to tell me that you actually believe that there was a giant fish created by God to swallow a prophet by the name of Jonah? No, I don't know anything about that either. All I can tell you is, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. This went on and on and on. The only scripture she knew was that one scripture, and the man got saved. The man got saved. Just a thought, guys, as we're ministering to those who are lost in this world, to take the message, the good news. Keep the apologetics. I think apologetics is good inside the church. We need to have it so that we can think critically when we're hearing teachers preach, and we're analyzing things, and we're taking it to the scriptures, and we're saying, "Hey, that matches up. Oh, that doesn't match up." But the non-believer just needs to hear the three things. We're sinners. We all are. And I don't really care what your sin is. You're a sinner. We all need a Savior. Jesus Christ is that Savior. And you can commit your life to Him, and you could be set free from the shame and guilt that have ruled and kept you in bondage. Isn't that the message? That's it. Keep it that simple. It's not my responsibility to save anybody. It is not my responsibility to save anybody. It's just my responsibility to be like the angels and say, "Hey, He has risen from the grave." And you gals, you go back and tell the apostles. You go back and tell the disciples. Well, they're going to drag Him to the tomb, right? Or they're not going to have to drag Him. They're going to run. There's going to be a foot race, actually. Peter responds by going to the tomb in Luke 24, verse 12. "But Peter arose and ran to the tomb and stooped down, and he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves. And he departed, and what is he doing? Marveling to himself at what had happened." Now, we know from John's account that John was a faster jogger. I love that account in John chapter 20. You know, let me read it. I know I like reading. There's certain things I just love, and I always try to interject them into no matter where I'm at in the text teaching this message. But in John 20, it says this in verse 3, "Peter therefore went," and the other disciple, you see, John never names himself, but it's John, "and we're going to the tomb." So they both ran together, and the other disciple, John, "I outran Peter and came to the tomb first." I mean, I'm telling you, you can hear the bragging rights here. I mean, I'm not, okay, especially for us boys. I mean, we all grew up with, "I finished my dinner faster than you." Right? How many guys recognize what I'm saying? Raise my hand. Don't leave me alone on this. Come on. Now, maybe you girls didn't think that way. You know? My gosh, everything was a competition. "I finished in the bathroom before you." Well, I didn't know it was a competition, but it is now. Too much information. Verse 5, "And he stooped down and looking in saw the linen cloth lying there, yet he did not go in." Ooh, so John was okay with beating him to the tomb, but he didn't go in. "Then Peter came and followed him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloth lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloth, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciples who came to the tomb first went in also and saw and believed. For as yet, they did not know the scriptures that he must be raised again the third day. I don't know how they didn't know. Then the disciples went away again to their own homes. Now we know from this moment on that they have encounters with the risen Lord. And in particular, Peter is being restored at the end of John's Gospel, chapter 21. And all these guys, their lives were changed radically. From this being on fire for Jesus, walking with him, thinking that he was going to rule and reign and they were going to be at his right hand and his left hand, to this, uh-oh, he's arrested, uh-oh, he's going to the cross, to not even being around, to Peter denying him on the cross. He denied him three times. Hiding, cowering. Jesus comes, they see him. Remember, Thomas goes, hey, I'm not going to believe unless I can put my hand in the finger and in the side. He did, and what did Jesus say? Jesus says, hey, don't be doubting anymore, be believing. They're told to wait in the upper room. Acts chapter 2, wait for the promise of the Father. The Holy Spirit is going to come upon you, upon, and empower you to be bold and to be witnesses into this lost world. And that's exactly what took place on the day of Pentecost. So they had to go through this process. They went through the process on the day of Pentecost. They were baptized. The Holy Spirit came upon them. They were empowered to go out into the world and to be witnesses. And did they ever? And did they ever? Peter's first message is, hey, men and brethren, these aren't drunk like you supposed. No, no, this is what Joel prophesied. They're just filled with the Holy Spirit. He is outpouring his Holy Spirit, just like Joel said he did. He said he would. He was going to do it. Here it is. This is what you're seeing. This is what you're witnessing. By the way, you guys crucified him, but God allowed it to happen. But you need to repent, and you need to come to him. And what? 3,000 people were added to the church that day. He went from denying the Lord to a little girl to preaching that bold message in Acts chapter 2. Why? Because of the resurrected body of Jesus Christ and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Lives radically changed, and ours have been too. And let me encourage you on boldness, my precious brothers and sisters. We need to be bold like never before. Not rude, but bold, gentle, kind. We're ministering to people in mom's skilled nursing facility. A little touch on the shoulder to the gentleman who's in the wheelchair. A little high five to the guy who can't hear anything. A little thank you to the gal who's helped my mom so much as I walked out. Using her name, looking her in the eyes. Telling her how much God loves her. Yesterday, we're walking in, my wife meets a gal we've never met before. Her dad is just in the beginning stages of dementia, Alzheimer's. And her dad and my mom have somehow connected somehow. And so all of a sudden, Judy and her connect. And then she comes in to meet my mom. And she starts talking about her dad, and she starts to tear up. And I just look at her and said, oh, I'm so sorry. I know. She looked back at us. Tears were welling up in our eyes, and our eyes, right there, we're praying for her. I don't know if she's a believer or not. Judy goes, let me grab your hand. We're going to pray right now. We just lay hands on her. We pray. That's what I'm talking about, my precious brothers and sisters. Why? Because Jesus has raised from the dead. And if my mom's presence in there means that we get to go there to touch some people's lives, God help us, we're nobody, then so be it. Glory to God. Because of the resurrection. And I'm just one beggar telling another beggar where to find the hope. And it isn't in me, it's in our Lord, amen. See, the resurrection proves Jesus' claims. It proves that he is true. It proves that he is who he said he was. It is. It proves that God accepted his sacrifice. It proves that the bill of debt for our sins has been paid in half. Has been paid in what?
Full.
One more time. Has been paid in?
Full.
Done. Don't argue with God. Right? I don't deserve it, Lord. You've never. I'm going to have to hold this over my head for the next 40 years. Uh-uh. He says it was finished to tetelestai on the cross. Would you please live in the victory I purchase you? The resurrection pictures how we are to live. Dead to ourselves and alive to God. The resurrection proves us a friend. We don't have a dead Christ, we have a living Lord. And we have a very intimate and special relationship with the living God. He knows my name. And we have a lot of wonderful conversations, just him and I. And I don't know how he talks to you guys, because he's so busy talking to me. But he is. The resurrection points to the future glory we have in Christ. Amen. I'm homesick. You know, we're talking about inflation this morning in prayer over here. And like, all I'm doing is getting depressed. I got to get up and walk away. Sorry, I didn't want to hurt anybody's feeling, but I mean, inflation's crazy. You know, it's just weird. I mean, I said, it's like, you know, like I walked to the store with my wife. I said, stop buying anything. I mean, it's like 10 bucks for that, 10 bucks for this, 10 bucks. I mean, come on. I mean, she's got four items in the cart for Amazon, and it's almost 80 bucks. And I'm thinking, there's four items. It shouldn't be anywhere close to 80 bucks. It doesn't matter. God said he'll take care of us. He'll take care of us. We got to do our part and be responsible citizens. Please, I'm not talking about neglecting our responsibilities. But my focus is heavenward, amen. I can't wait to be there with him. Until then, I'm going to plow hard and work hard and just try to love on as many people as I can and share the truth, be bold, because he's coming back and he's coming back soon. And the resurrection proves it, amen. Thank you, Lord. Lord, how do we thank you, Lord? You know, you told us, actually. We thank you by believing on you. And if you're here this morning and you've never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today could be the day that you could open your heart and say, yes, I know I'm a sinner and I need a Savior, and I recognize Jesus is Lord. He is God. He is my Savior. And then I'm going to receive him into my heart as Lord and Savior. I'm going to confess my sins. I'm going to repent. I'm going to turn to him. I'm going to have a change of mind, a change of heart. And it's a simple prayer. It's, God, save me. God, save me. Lord, I receive what it is that you've done. And then you're born again. The Spirit now becomes alive in you. And for those who are saved today, my precious brothers and sisters, lay hold again of the promises of the resurrection, that your sins have been demolished at the cross of Christ. That your guilt and your shame have been swallowed up by his love. And that he loves you with everything. And set your hearts ablaze, afresh and anew, if you will, to follow him with your whole life and with your whole heart. We love you, Lord. We just stand in awe of who you are. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You know, at this moment, you know, here's what I want to do. I don't know if I'm throwing the worship team of curveball, but let's just sit still and let them sing this song. And then after the song, we'll have the guys come up and pass out the elements, and then we'll receive those elements together. But let's just, you know, close our eyes, raise your hands to the Lord, and in communion, we need to examine ourselves to make sure that we're not lying to ourselves. Have the Lord speak to you. We need to reconcile if there's another person who needs to be reconciled with. We need to remember. So spend some time remembering what it is Jesus did for you. But then focus in on the resurrection and focus in on the future promise of living with him in glory. And let's just sing this song with that frame of mind. Amen.
Yeah.
never going to die. Yeah, give the Lord a hand. Sure, give him a hand. You and I are never going to die if you're in Christ, amen?
That's right.
Man, I hope none of you guys beat me home. I don't want to do any memorial services for anybody. I mean, I will, but I would prefer us all to go together, amen?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Let's all go together. Oh, thank you, Lord. Can I get the guys to come forward and pass out the elements at this time? And you know, I love that song. One of my greatest fears in life is that I'd have to do it without my precious bride. Right? I could just start crying right now thinking about it. But that song came on the other day, and it just so ministered to my heart that no matter what trials I may have to face, I'm okay because He lives. And He loves me. And I don't know what trial you're having to face or may be worried about, like me, the future. Why do I worry about the future? Right? He holds the future in His hands. But my precious brothers and sisters, if there is something that you are struggling with right now, a trial, you know, you have maybe physical stuff going on that no one knows about. Maybe you're being attacked spiritually. Maybe it's just a headache, whatever it is. We can face tomorrow because we know that He is there and that He lives. And so be encouraged by that. And what we're celebrating here with communion is the very fact of what He wants us to celebrate. We called it Good Friday for a reason, because what happened was good. Oh, I mean, I know it's hard, and I know it's horrible on one side of it, right? We're thinking, oh my gosh, why did my Savior have to die for me? But He did. That's what's great about it. And so as you hold the bread, remember what it is that He did. He did it because He loved you. well, I just kind of like Jeff. Maybe I'll save him. You don't kind of go to the cross and suffer the things you do because you kind of like me, right? No. You really incredibly kind of really love me. So would you receive that this morning? Would you? Will you stop holding that old guilt that you've been holding on to for however many years over your head and let it go? Will you? Or do you guys, you want to punish yourself for a couple more minutes? I'll count down, 2 minutes. That's all you get. And after that, you're free, okay? Isn't that the best news in the whole world? I just don't know why more people don't want to grab hold of it. Amen. But we hold this bread. I like to break it. Now, some of you don't have to do this, but I like to break it because it reminds me that his body was broken for me personally. So I break it, and let's read the text in Corinthians. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. He took the bread, and then when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which has been broken for you, and do this in remembrance of me. And so that's what we do this afternoon, or this morning, I should say. We hold this broken piece of bread in our hands, and we say, thank you, Jesus. And we recognize I'm never going to be able to earn it, never deserved it. I could spend several eternities trying to, but can't. But I'm going to receive it. So thank you, Father. How do we say thank you? You said to say thank you with our lives, to be obedient, to love you back, to receive your forgiveness, and to move forward in the victory that you purchased for us at Calvary. That's how we say thank you. And we say thank you, Lord. Let's partake together. Let's hold this cup. And in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. And so, Lord, we look at this cup and we know that it means all the guilt and shame were covered by your blood. You told us in Isaiah that our sins were like crimson, but you have made them as white as snow. And Lord, help us to catch up to the reality that you have purified us, that you've made us brand new, that we are in Christ new. Help us to catch up to that reality, the victory that you've given us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's partake. Well, I don't know about you, but that's what the resurrection represents, and I hope that this has been encouraging to you. I know I've been encouraged. So I can say I always enjoy studying it. I always enjoy teaching it. I never get tired of hearing the stories. I never get tired of repeating the stories. I'm just struck on Mary. I tell you, every resurrection season, I own Mary and Jesus at that tomb because I love the intimacy I have with Christ. Don't you? He gets me in the truest sense, not the campaign. No, he understands me, and he wants to change me and make me more like him. Glory be to God, amen? Amen. Hey, let's stand and celebrate the fact that we're never going to die. I believe. I just got to say, you guys have improved a little on the clapping. But we got to get better. I mean, I don't know what to say. I don't have any. I'm not being critical. I have zero. I always find myself clapping on the offbeat. Does anybody rate? I mean, that's just me. Anyways, go out and celebrate today. Amen. And you're free in Christ. He sets us free. God bless you guys. Oh, if you haven't received Christ and you want to do so, come and find me, Pastor Vic. We have a gift down here. We'll get in your hands, and we'll pray with you. And so God bless you guys.
That's okay.